welcome to the Verge, first ever Verge Book Club podcast. I'll be your host today, Josh Topolsky. I'm Josh Topolsky all the time, but today I'm also going to be hosting the Book Club podcast. And with me is the beautiful, the delightful Laura June, who is an editor, and also we're married, I should tell you now, for full disclosure. And a very special guest, Lev Grossman, who is the Time book critic. The Time book critic.
That is the article you're looking for.
And author of the New York Times best-selling Magicians series of books. So, and thank you for joining us.
It's my pleasure.
And I assume, well, I know, Philip K. Dick fan and Ubik lover.
Yes, both of those things.
Right. Well, thank you for joining us. So, just in case you don't know, if you just tuned into this and you don't know what's going on, we last month, September, we read Ubik, which is a Philip K. Dick novel, in the Verge Book Club, and now we're discussing it. We have some questions from book club members who read it, and we're just going to talk about the book and what it means. Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yeah. So, what I wanted to start with was. One of the reasons that I asked Lev to do this was that that you included the book on the time list of the 100 best novels since, I think it was 1923, which is when Time started publishing.
Not only did I do that, just to break in, I just turned over my copy of Ubik to find my own name on the back.
You're quoted
which
on
is
the back.
So
is that
similar.
Right? Let me see that.
I don't even want to look at the money in my pocket because it might possibly have my face on it too.
This is, in this context,
very disconcerting.
So if you read the, what edition is this? This is the brand new Mariner.
One. Yes.
Lev is quoted quite prominently. I mean, before the description of the book, even.
Although, look, they've got Adam Gopnik on the cover, which I don't know how that decision was made.
That is
frustrating. Adam's always getting there before me.
And I'm personally a fan. I'm gonna write to Mariner.
If you would, yeah.
But so. I did not know that. It's interesting. Can I read the quote since we're talking about
it?
If you don't have the book. From the stuff of space opera, Dick spins a deeply unsettling existential horror story, a nightmare you'll never be sure you've woken up from. Lev Grossman, Time.
Yeah, and one of our readers actually took a small bit of issue with it, which I do want to, with the quote, which I do want to get to later. But
we're going to attack Lev right off the bat.
But the first thing I want to talk about is Philip K. Dick as a thing. And I think
he was a person.
He was a person, and he was a really prolific writer, but he was not a very well-respected writer for most of his career. And I think that that's changed pretty drastically in the last 5 to 10 years. And Ubik was not the first book of his that I read. Mm-hmm. I think it was the second or the third.
What was the first book?
I think it was Flow My Tears, The Policeman Said.
Yeah.
Or...
Scanner Darkly.
No.
Three Stigmata.
No, I've never read that one.
The Three Stigmata is the Transmigrator. I was thinking of the Valis. I think you started reading Valis trilogy.
I started,
and that you didn't finish it.
Yeah,
have you read it?
I have, but not everybody comes out the other side of that.
No. Yes, I did not.
Well, it's interesting. Sorry, I don't mean to derail
That's
you.
Okay.
But to your quote, that quote I think is very applicable in terms of the Valis trilogy, particularly the first book, which. Made me feel like I was going a little nuts while reading it.
Yeah.
Not that we're here to talk about that, but anyhow.
I mean, I wanted to just briefly talk about, you know, I started reading his books 5 to 7 years ago, and I came to it through you. Mm. You were a big fan. Mm. And you're obviously a big fan. And I think that, you know, I think that he's having like a moment. He's having an obvious resurgence, and my question is why.
Do you want to take this?
Well, that's a good question. I mean, he has been in the process of resurging for some time.
How long would you say?
Well, ever since Blade Runner, really.
I guess so.
Which is right after he
died. But Blade Runner was a bomb. I mean, it was not a success.
No, that's true.
As
it was
film
a slow burn.
It took another. I remember it was re-released. They did a limited re-release 10 years later, and in 92.
Right.
I feel like it started in the 90s. Really, with kind of not to jump in here, but Blade Runner. I feel like there was a big period post Blade Runner where he wasn't relevant, and then something happened in the mid 90s where. I think Blade Runner, people woke up to the idea that it was actually a really great, cool movie that didn't suck. just because they didn't like it the first time around. That it was, it became like a cult thing. You know, I think it stewed for a while. You know, yeah. And once it was on video. I mean, were they even? Did they even have VHS tapes in the 80s, in the mid 80s?
Yes.
Yeah.
I don't know. Yes. I was alive then.
Yeah. So was I. It's all a blurry memory. But
I think, you know, the thing that I focus on really is the way that in Dick's books, technology is not the source of certainty. Technology does not give firm answers. If anything, it blurs the lines of reality. It's not about calculating values precisely. It's not about solving problems. And in fact, in the guise of solving problems, it in fact adds new ones, even more intractable ones. It destabilizes things in ways that it was never meant to. And that's something that Dick awoke to very early, and I think we're still just awakening to it.
And the technology is also, I mean, strictly speaking about like the things that are not the people in his books, it seems to be almost often a backdrop or just a kind of trigger for a much deeper psychological sort of trauma of the characters, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, in Ubik, for instance, the technology is, I mean, there's almost no technology really. I mean, there is this technology of Half-Life, right? Mm-hmm. Which is, you know, they don't go into great, he doesn't really go into great detail about how it works exactly. But then there's lots of like meddling minor technology mm-hmm. that is there to like, you know, there are many things that are barriers to the characters in this book. And there are, you know, one of the things that just keeps hanging around everywhere is this, the minor technological barrier. Every time Joe Chip wants to do something simple, like open a door, mm-hmm. which is an odd, you know, it's an odd way to think of technology as not as an enabler, but it is exactly the opposite.
Yeah, well, it's an enabler for the people who are getting the money.
Right.
It's a way of establishing control and centralizing control among a small group of people of whom one is not a member.
Right.
I think what's interesting about Half-Life, as if you look at it as a technology, is almost instantly in the book, my favorite character, Runciter, is he very clearly, like, when he is visiting his wife for the first time, it sort of sets up the entire prospect of this thing as a technological advance that society has made. He muses almost immediately that he, like, wish it hadn't happened or that it wasn't an option. Mm-hmm. He says, is this better than the old way, the direct road from full life to the grave? I still do have her with me. In a sense, he decided, the alternative is nothing. So really early on, he's, like, philosophically sort of saying, like, well, maybe it was better before.
Yeah. So,
and I think that actually, for me, pervades like the entire rest of the book. That's mm-hmm. what the rest of the book is about for me.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Let me ask this. We were talking about this on the way over. What is Ubik about? I have my ideas, but what do you think Ubik is supposed to be about? Like, what was the point? I know that's a broad question, by the way, but I feel like it's a kind of a dumb question that I'd like to hear people's answers to, because I think there's a lot of ways to interpret it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I don't think it's reducible to a single point. What do I imagine Dick experiencing as he wrote Ubik? I read it, and I think of someone who is writing rapidly, as Dick, I think, did, and improvising. There's this incredible profusion of ideas and plot lines and trying to manage them. And, you know, one of the wonderful things that happens in Ubik is the characters are basically trying to read the book they're in. They're trying to interpret the nature of the reality into which they've been inserted. And you feel Dick trying to figure it out as he goes along as well. He's improvising crazily. He's got all these plot lines, all these herrings. All of them are turning out to be red. And he's thinking, how am I going to wrap all this up neatly? How am I going to bring it in for a landing? And he starts to realize that the mess resembles his life more closely than anything like a neatly, tidily wrapped up thriller. He begins to realize that the state of permanent uncertainty is much more like real life than anything sort of less fantastical would be.
Yeah, there is this feeling and something that I found myself like kind of stopping and thinking about while I was reading this off the cuff feeling that he was writing rapidly, and that there are moments that had they been more considered. And by the way, I mean, I'm a fan of his. I'm happy he's rapidly written this, you know, or we assume that he has. But things that just from another writer, there would be situations that I think to me they were difficult to understand when reading, just difficult to accept. For instance, mm-hmm. Towards the end of the book, when Joe Chip is starting to be weakened by the entropic forces, he says, you know, it's Pat. Pat is doing all of this, and so immediately Pat becomes, you know, she was like vaguely villainous throughout most of the book, mm-hmm. and then becomes completely, you know, becomes the villain,
yeah.
At least at that point. And, you know, he's like, I'm going to go to my room and lay down. And by the way, everybody at this point knows that going to your room to lay down is definitely and Joe has even said, he said, don't let anybody go off alone because yeah. that'll be the end of them.
Yeah.
And then Pat's like, I'll walk you to your room. And you know, I think I think had this book been maybe less rapidly written or a different author, you know, Joe Chip would have said, no, thanks. You're the bad guy here. He's yeah. like, okay, fine. Walk me in my room. And they have this kind of weird conversation where she's taunting him
yeah.
as he's weakening and getting to his room.
A magnificent sequence. I was just longing to see that on film.
Yeah.
You know, her standing over him and him sort of basically crawling up the stairs.
Yeah. And this is something that it's interesting you mentioned that because Dick wrote a screenplay for Ubik. Which I have not read. I actually started reading a little bit of it, and I was disappointed immediately with it. And because it kind of was different than my vision of the book, which actually was out of print for a long time. It's just come back into print. But have you read it?
No.
Have you read the screenplay? But this is one of his books that I saw so clearly the first time I read it, you know, 10 years ago or when I was even longer, and rereading it again, it just seems so filmic to me. The arc of it is so, it has such a propulsive arc.
Mm.
Was that something that has, I mean, you mentioned it as something you wanted to see on film. Is that something that you thought of as you were reading this?
Oh, God, yes. I even thought, yeah, I know how to do this, man. They should just call me.
They should.
Because I could get this thing done on film. Because it's so propulsive and yet so just strangely ambiguous and shadowy at the same time. Everything is concrete. And you can see the details very clearly, but the big picture is just nowhere.
Yeah.
I think that actually leads to one of the questions that sort of repeats over and over again. And I think it's more about us as modern readers than it is about him. And maybe it's more about the context he was writing in and the time he was writing in. When was this originally published?
60-something. I don't
yeah.
know. I may have invented that number.
It's late 60s.
65?
69. So
pretty close.
I think, you know, a question that's come up over and over again with our readers is this ending satisfying? And I think that, oddly, for a lot of them, it's not. And I think it's because the ending is, you can interpret it almost however you want. And it sort of forces you to, not however you want, but it forces you to recast everything that's gone before it, but not in a neat sort of like Sixth Sense way. And I think...
Well, it doesn't answer every question, does it?
Right.
I mean,
its sort of beauty is in its lack of finality or right. its lack of answering everything up. Everything's not neatly... Like you said, the sort of concrete details are sort of neatly wrapped up, but the larger questions are... Like, what's happened?
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of our readers are kind of not happy with that.
Todd, I this is my favorite kind of ending. I mean, it's
mine
it's,
too.
I would be less satisfied if it ended on a note where everything was neatly wrapped up and it didn't leave you asking questions at the end of it. Lev, I don't know what your take on it is, but
I love the ending. I adore it, and I feel as though all the space for ambiguity and ontological uncertainty that he spent the whole book creating, for him to abolish it at the end with a pad ending would have been, I think, to me, disappointing. I read a very, there's a famous Marxist interpretation of Ubik, which has to do with it being an attack on all kinds of capitalist delusions, and one of them being the satisfying ending. He wanted to blow up Ubik as a sort of satisfying commodity. You pay your $16.99 or whatever, and you get your pat sense of certainty. He wanted to take that away and say, this is not, you know, this is not a commodity. This is something else, something more complex.
That's an interesting interpretation. The idea that Dick would, and maybe I don't understand him enough as a writer, but the idea that he would go into a book thinking, I'm going to write a novel that blows up sort of capitalist concepts. I mean, there's certainly that, the thread of, you know, I think a perspective of someone who is outside of sort of the capitalist thinking, you know, and has perhaps been beaten down by it. I mean, Joe Chip, I mean, I don't know, maybe I'm reading into this, but I feel like the Joe Chip character is Philip K. Dick in this book. I mean, I know that every character is the author in some way, but
right.
I feel like there's something that's, you know, what I know of Philip K. Dick as a man, there is something, you know, this kind of downtrodden, beaten by the system, you know, extremely brilliant, but unlucky. Guy.
Well, you start looking for that stuff in the book, and it's everywhere. I mean, these little refrains before each chapter, written in actually really good impressions of sort of period advertising speak, you know, with this cubic commodity promising to solve all your problems, these household appliances that hassle you and negotiate with you and give you shit if you can't come up with a nickel. I mean, he lives, you know, utterly embedded in this toxic capitalist matrix, which has, you know, permeated these every little part of his existence. I mean, you can read it that way, and it's very productive.
I like that Ubik is also, it's not just that, it is a great impersonation of the kind of advertising copy of the 60s, but, and to this day, really, but it's also highly dangerous. Whatever the product that is being advertised, it will solve a lot of problems for you. It has to be used as directed. Otherwise,
do not taunt Happy Fun.
No, that's exactly, and that's
it's exactly that,
that was something of. that I thought of rereading it that I hadn't noticed either. I never made the connection, but I don't know if everybody listening knows the Happy Fun Ball sketch from Saturday Night Live, but it was about this, you know, this is just the kind of toy ball that would bounce, but was highly volatile and, you know, could not be, there were just things you could not do, like you could take Happy Fun Ball out after midnight and, you know, it was like a gremlin, basically.
Yeah, yeah, right.
But it is all Ubik in these ads, and they're kind of floating out there in the ether. I mean, those ads are not, they're not seen on TV. They're not, it's not something that the characters in the book perceive. And in fact, it doesn't even seem to be a reflection of what Ubik is, really.
Well, Ubik doesn't enter the book as like a thing until maybe the second half, right?
Oh, I think it's later.
Maybe later. Yeah, it's very late.
It's really like towards...
But it's sort of these introductions, these ads, and I think that our readers definitely picked up on it. I don't think they were thinking of Marxist interpretations, but our readers definitely picked up on the weird like consumerism of the book. Mm-hmm. And I think that these little blurbs at the beginning of every chapter are there because, I mean, there's a couple of ways to use like blurby introductions to chapters, and he uses them in one of the sort of classically interesting ones, which is like he throws it out there and then it has nothing to do with the text.
Right. Well, it's one of the, as Lev said, there are a lot of red herrings. Right. This is actually one that's not exactly a red herring, but it feels that way up until about the last, in the final, you know, quarter of the book.
I think it directs your attention in a particular way. And I think that that's why, even before Ubik comes in as a character, you are already sort of aware of like the sort of weird consumerism, I think is the best word.
Right.
Well, for what's going on in the beginning.
It certainly
of the
makes
book.
You want to know what Ubik is, since it has so many uses, you know.
But I don't think there's any one sort of conceptual framework that kind of exhausts the power of the book. I mean, obviously this is powerful thing having to do with women. This is very sort of Madonna whore thing, where you have sort of the bad sort of sexual woman in the form of Pat and the angelic savior in the form of Ella.
Yeah. Well, and there's also, but in the, and it's, there's Wendy is sort of presented as a more angelic, more sort of soft character who immediately shrivels up and dies at the supposedly at that point, thanks to Pat.
I had this genius moment when I was reading it. I'm thinking, picturing the movie of it. They'd get a hold of the surveillance tapes of the hotel, and they'd see her sort of creeping down the hallway,
struggling
in her desiccated state.
It's really the most terrifying part just of the book.
It's interesting that I just realized this as you mentioned that it's hotels.
Yeah,
hotels are also a prominently figure in the deaths of characters. I mean, I just realized that at the end. I mean, they could have been anywhere. They could have been in a They could have been at the funeral home. They could have been, you know, at somebody's house.
Yeah.
But they end up in another hotel.
Yeah, which, again, I keep coming back to the Marxist thing. I mean, everything about this world which Joe inhabits, somehow it's impermanent, right? If you leave it alone for too long, if you stop pumping money into it, it starts to regress and rot and fall apart and collapse under you, which is just like hotels. You know, it's not like a house that you own that you live in. The minute you stop pumping money into it, you get turfed out.
Well, everything is rented. Everything is it is like rent-a-center world.
Yeah.
You know, like you're paying monthly for or daily or at moment by moment to use it. You know, it's just the basic things in your house, your coffee maker.
Yeah.
And it does seem that it is a very transitional kind of state. All of these characters are not. I mean, they are literally in a transitional state, or so we are led to believe. But then, in a more sort of permanent way, in that world, it's a transitional world where everything is kind of and transactional. It's that's interesting to think about because it kind of makes. When you think about it, paints this everything is up for grabs. Everything seems to be a question. Everything seems to be like a debate or a barter.
Right.
And there really is like a lot of bartering towards the end of the book about, you know, Joe's condition is almost he almost barters in some way with Pat about it. But do we have reader questions? I'd like to get to some of the.
Well, I mean, we are sort of actually moving through them.
Are we going through them?
Yeah.
I don't want to. I mean, I think that we can.
You know,
riff on this.
I think this sort of leads to the next question that a lot of readers had, which is Philip K. Dick a bad writer? And I think...
No. He's the greatest writer ever.
Very early on in the book, so I've been discussing the book in our forums for over a month with the readers, and so I went through chapter by chapter, and very early on someone brought this up, and I think it was Jesse Hicks, who also is a big... Philip K. Dick fan, sort of said, well, you know, in the sort of Philip K. Dick fan community, you know, there are a couple of schools of thought, but one of them is that he's this brilliant person whose ideas are often better than his prose. And I do agree that can be true of him, and I don't believe that's what's going on in this book. I think... I actually, rereading it, this is the second time I've read it, I actually find this book to be fairly sort of beautifully thought out and beautifully written. I know that he's known for making things up as he goes along. I don't know if he's doing that all the way here because it's so beautifully put together. So he's either even more of a genius than I previously thought he was, or meaning he can make stuff up as he goes along and it turns out just like fantastic. Or, you know, he's sort of a... And I think that this actually goes back to my original point and maybe the reason that he wasn't thought of as a great writer for a really long time is because a lot of people still read his stuff and say he's not really that great of a writer.
Well, I think, you know, I don't think he's that interested in sentences. I don't think he's that interested in words, in turns of phrase, in lyrical language. He does not write like Virginia Woolf. There aren't a lot of layers... You know, to the way he chooses words and puts them together. Some of them are very clumsy, but you know, one of the reasons I think he's become more well thought of recently is that we're kind of getting out from under this modernist idea that books are about beautiful language, and we're paying more attention, I think, to narrative. And a book that is more closely worked and finely constructed on a narrative level, I would be at a loss to name than Ubik. If you think of writers being, you know. Wolf is probably more interested in language than narrative. You could throw the slider totally the other way. You get someone like Dick, who's not a stylist at all. But on the level of plot, he's a virtuoso. I mean, nobody constructs things the way he does.
I think there's also a kind of. I think there is some very beautiful writing in this book and in many of his books that does not hit the classic. I don't think it is in the classic confines of beautiful prose. I think it is something that is very modern. I think it is something that is very, I think I and maybe this is why, you know, in the last 25 years or so, or whatever the time frame is, 10 years, that Dick has become not just more palatable, but extremely popular. Because I think there's something very modern in the way that he writes. And there are, he describes situations of extreme distress in a way that I think is fantastically mm-hmm. beautiful. And I think that, you know, since his books are filled with paranoia and filled with dread and filled with the sense that the world is not what it seems and that the things that you've been told are lies and maybe you're not who you think you are. I mean, and that's really, you know, every book of his. I mean, there's threads of that. I think that as our kind of condition, our modern condition has come
we're
up.
We're like catching up
I think
with
we're
him.
Catching up to Dick. I think we're catching up to the idea that, you know, the world's, you know, we're in the midst of a big conspiracy theory in some ways, not quite as extreme as what Dick, you know, we're not living in, you know, what Roman era with a, you know, mask of reality pulled down in front of us, but, or whatever the Valis premise is, there is, I think, this kind of beautiful paranoid prose in the book, particularly when describing situations that are, I mean, when he's describing the decay, that when Joe Chip, that scene, you know, where he's working his way up the steps and he's describing what's happening to him mm-hmm. and the forces that are working upon him.
Yeah, there's an oceanic pull on him, yeah. Which I thought,
it's extremely dramatic and it's, I think, really beautiful. And I think that he's at his best, you know, I think of Martian Time Slip. Have you read Martian Time Slip? It covers, you know, similar. There's the main character of the book is essentially pulls people into this decaying worldview, mm-hmm. and when he's describing the decay and the kind of the crushing entropy of this world, it's really beautiful. And so I think that he can be very matter of fact in the kind of moment to moment action of the story. But then there are other moments, particularly the darkest moments, that I think he's really a beautiful writer. Mm. And I think it mirrors the paranoia that the more modern paranoia, and I think maybe that's why it's started to appeal to a broader. And then again, I think maybe people just didn't know that Dick existed up until 20 years ago.
Yeah.
I mean, that's my impression. I started reading Philip K. Dick because of Blade Runner, mm-hmm. because I knew it was based on a book and I went and read it. That was the first book I read of his. It's kind of a challenging book, actually, for him.
Yeah.
I mean, I think Ubik is a very readable book, you know? Mm-hmm. With a great, very clear narrative. I feel like Duane's Dream of Electric Sheep is a much harder book to get through. Maybe I'm crazy.
By the way, the first time I read Ubik, I had been living in a cabin in Maine all by myself for a month at that point. And I was running out of money to keep the cabin heated. It was getting colder and colder every day. And at some point in that span of time, I thought, I've got this Ubik book. I better pick it up. Don't ever do that.
An odd coincidence.
I nearly lost my. I read the last pages, like huddled over my stuff, kind of rocking to myself. Oh my God. Because I felt as though.
And you can't put it down once it hits a certain point towards the end of this book.
Yeah.
It's one of the. I mean, it really is a page turner in the sense that you just need to know, like, what is happening, right? Because you feel like everything is up, it becomes questionable. At the end, and you just so desperately want to know. Go on.
Oh, I just. Do you guys have a take on the ending? Do you have a read on what's happening in this final?
Yeah, that's final actually what I was just going to ask.
Yeah,
because I think that's the. Do you want to? Do you have a take?
I do. I mean, I think in terms of what's actually happening. I mean, maybe this is just the kind of reader I am. It was never. I mean, if you take everything that Ella says at face value, which is, we can get to that, which I don't know if you should, but if you do, then I think it's fairly clear, like, technically what is happening, which is that they've all been in Half-Life the entire time, ever since the explosion.
Including Runciter?
Including Runciter. I don't think that actually answers.
Is that your interpretation?
My interpretation is that. I would be interested to hear what better interpretation there is.
Lev, I'm curious. What is your take?
Well, the setup for Ubik is totally fascinating and, mm-hmm. and almost unique in that, you know, a normal writer would have chosen one premise. You would either have a world where there are psychics, and there is one particular anomalous psychic named Pat, and she has the ability to regress time, to go back in time and change decisions, to swap time streams. That would be enough.
Mm-hmm.
He adds this is two novels crushed into one.
Yep.
And then he has a second premise, which has to do with cold pack. You can live in the state of cold pack. Are you dead? Are you not? Nobody quite knows. So there's that too. So there's two destabilizing forces, which when they intersect and interfere with one another, create this incredible complexity, which I think nobody but he could manage. Basically, on the final page, you know, I oscillate between two readings. One, which is that everyone's in cold pack. Brunser's in cold pack too. And there's some kind of dynamic equilibrium whereby the more orderly Joe's world gets, the more Runciter's world starts to fall apart, and he starts to see Joe chip money, and you know that things are going to hell for him. And the other one is that Runciter is, in fact, the only one who's dead, and he has been hallucinating everything that's going on, including the whole narrative that happened to Chip. And, in fact, Chip is alive and is trying to reach him from outside. None of this takes into account Jory or Pat, and that's because I'm not as smart as Philip K. Dick.
Right. Well, I think this is the more out there concept, but that the book that everything is that there's a point where we're supposed to think something has happened and now everyone is dead, the explosion,
right.
Or some of these people are dead. I think that given the final moment, the final beat, right, it's possible that there's
a version with Pat. There's a version where Pat actually is just as important as she seems like she's going to be, right? Mm-hmm. There's a version maybe the explosion is not the event. Maybe there's something earlier.
There's that moment with Pat where she kind of transports Runciter. You know, he's like, what am I doing here?
He's like in New York City all of a sudden.
Yeah, he doesn't know where, you know, and then he comes back to the office and they have to figure out like how Pat. And there's, you know, people were asking, I think, at the book club, how do they have the records of Pat if she was never hired by Runciter? Or if she was hired under some thing where there's like this kind of, but it's like, hey, you know what? Philip K. Dick might have left a couple of hanging chats. It's possible that not every single thing was in order. But I do think there's that interpretation, the bigger, if you really zoom out, that all of it is a hallucination of Runciter or another character. But I do think you cannot end the book when he looks at the Joe Chip money and think that something has happened to Runciter. I mean, how else would he be looking at Joe Chip money unless Runciter's experience is a hallucination of Joe Chip or another? You know what I mean? Like that his character is not doing any of what seems to be it. You know, he seems to be doing, and that's, you know, I don't know. Dick shows him as a separate entity.
I think the book essentially requires you to accept that what it is doing is offering you an analogy to the uninterpretability of reality. The reality around you, you can never quite assemble it into a whole. There's actually a term, which I've forgotten, that's used by people who study conspiracy theories, has to do with the impossibility of assembling evidence into a coherent whole. There is always space for conspiracies. It seems to be a fact accepted within the realm of psychology and information science. You actually can't come up with a whole system where there is no ambiguity. And I feel like we sort of have to accept about Ubik that it is written that way in a way that emulates reality. It is not it's not reducible to a single coherent explanation, which does not make it unique by any means. It's a famous fact about The Big Sleep, one of my favorite novels by Raymond Chandler. Who killed the chauffeur? No one knows who kills the chauffeur. It happens early on. Everyone's forgotten about it by the end of the book. But in fact, if you go back, there's just no way to know who killed him or why.
I thought you were going to hit us with a theory.
No, I got nothing. I don't think Chandler knew. I think it was just one of those balls of yarn that you can't ravel up completely.
Yeah.
I think, actually, that's one of my favorite things about certain types of literature. And this fits there. And I think but I also think it's the rub. I think it's the reason that some modern readers, maybe non-modern readers, maybe all readers, maybe it's a personality type that is what bothers them, is that there's not an answer for every single thing. I think the idea, like you said, that maybe Raymond Chandler didn't know who killed the chauffeur, which implies that maybe it's not important. The whole point is that there's something you don't know.
Right.
Or
it's not important to that particular story. It's just a detail.
It's important that it's there. And it's important that there's something you don't know.
Right.
But it's not important. Like, he wrote the story, that if he wrote it without an answer, that means that there isn't an answer and that there can't be one.
But I think what's most impressive about Ubik and many of Dick's books is that, you know, he doesn't just not answer a question. I mean, he answers a question in one way, and he doesn't just say, like, well, it's open to interpretation, but he gives you an avenue through which you can see, or by which you can see the answer, that you kind of sense that if you don't know the answer, it's because you haven't studied it enough or haven't figured it out, but not because there isn't an answer. I think one of the things that is most upsetting to me in fiction is when somebody's presented and it's either a red herring or unanswerable, and there is no essential, like, backstory for that thing. And mm-hmm. I think in this book in particular, if what you think at the end is, if you believe that it's true that Runciter is also dead, there's an explanation for what's happened, you know, and your mind can put together the explanation. Mm-hmm. I would find it very unsatisfying if it just ended with a kind of weird red herring ending and there wasn't a backstory. But Dick actually gives a really good, solid, he at least puts this element into the world, which is Cold Pack and Half-Life, that allows that ending to work, you know, whether you accept it or not.
I think the most amazing thing about the book is exactly what you said, which is that it's kind of two books smashed together. And I think you can identify that through either the events or the sort of, like, technological existence of what's going on, or through the characters. And the reason is, like, in the very beginning of the book, he presents a character and a technological thing. He presents Ella and he presents Half-Life. And they're very quickly, like, not important at all.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, what's really important are the sort of precogs, the psychics, all of the people with special powers, and the fact that they need to go on this journey to... And you sort of forget about Half-Life, and you sort of forget about Ella. And then at the end, it turns out that that's probably, like, the most important... If you accept what he presents to you, which is that they're likely... What Joe comes to believe, which is that they're likely all in Half-Life... then again, it's like he's sort of set up these couple of issues in the beginning. Then they're sort of like, oh, that's not important now. This is what's actually going on. Then you sort of jam on that for 150 pages. And then at the end, you're like, oh, no.
Well, do you think that was, is that, I wonder if, did he just get to a point where he was like, I got to resolve this? I mean, did Dick do outlines? Was this the, I mean, my impression, and maybe you know better than I do, Lev, because I haven't read a lot about his process mm-hmm. of writing. I've read a lot of his writing, but not his process. My impression, because I know that at some point he was kind of a speed junkie. I mean, I know that he was doing a lot of drugs while writing. Did I just make that up? I didn't just make that up, did I?
I don't think you did.
Okay.
I don't think so.
My impression is that he would kind of sit down. Maybe not this book, but some books, but sit down and just write until it was done without, you know, like I said, I don't know his process, but that's the way it feels, where he just kind of starts with this idea and goes till the idea has resolved in some way that he feels satisfied with or that matched, you know, his deadline for, you know, whatever he was doing. Is that, do you know if that was?
I don't know. I don't even think it's necessarily that fruitful to try to reconstruct his process. The effect that the book has is of, I mean, if you've ever tried to write a novel, this is a masterpiece of misdirection. It's, he does what magicians do, you know, he makes you look over here when he's, you know, when he's palming the coin over there. So you're spending a lot of time looking at, you know, Des Moines in 1939. You've forgotten about Ella and Jory, but he's got them right there. And, you know, when he needs them, then they appear. He waits just long enough so there's no possible chance you could come back to it. You could have come back to it on your own. But you still remember it. It's somewhere in the back of your head. And then he produces it like that out of nowhere. Just like technically as a matter of craft, it's astounding when you read it.
It's also... incredibly relieving. I mean, the book gets so dark. He goes so dark, and it's so hopeless, you know. And you have completely forgotten that there's any chance of hope at that point. You kind of, it's almost like even the thing that he's presented as the hope, Ubik, has sorry, Jory can manipulate it in such a way that there's no hope for anybody to even get to it.
Yeah.
You know, it's like he puts the one thing you need just out of reach. Mm-hmm. And it just, and it becomes so kind of dark and confusing towards the end where he's, you know, he's going to dinner. It's so odd. This is the thing that I think is so odd about Dick. You know, Joe Chip picks up a girl on the street and he wants to take her to dinner. And there's this whole kind of muddied sequence where that's going on. But it just feels like this thing.
It's like a person who's given up.
Yeah. And then he reintroduces these characters that you did completely forget about and were so important, seemed so important right at the beginning of the mm-hmm. book. And so I have a question on that point. Okay. Do you want to say something?
I did, but I don't want to get in the way of your question.
Well, no, go ahead. I'll remember my
question. The only thing I'll say is that one of the things that I find so beautiful about this book is not just the way he manipulates certain narrative lines, but also the way that he invites in certain interpretive methodologies. He's almost playing with you on that level. He keeps telling you, oh, this is about advertising, this is about money, so think about that, right? And then just when you think, okay, I've sorted this out, this is a Marxist, allegory, and we're going to work it out in the level, he brings in sex, and you think, oh, right, okay, no, sorry, this is a psychoanalytical, psychosexual kind of drama, so we need to think about it in that terms, and it's all about filth and shame. And then, you know, he brings in another, he triggers another sort of reading technique for you. Oh, it's a mystery. It's a whodunit. You know, let's read it in those terms. He's constantly forcing you to shift the way you read the book. And just when you start to feel as though you're comfortable, he brings in something else. So, you know, Joe Chip jumps out of the car and starts hitting on this girl. And suddenly you think, right, oh, sex. Right. Forgot about that.
Yeah.
He just doesn't allow you to become comfortable.
Yeah. And even up to the final moment, you're still not comfortable when you put, and that's what I like about, I mean, this to me is, you know, it's a very David Lynch, you know, it's a very Lynchian sort of unsettled feeling that it ends, like many Dick books, in a way that it's, you know, it's not satisfying, like everything's wrapped up and they went and got married and had, you know, babies or whatever, whoever the characters may be. It is that feeling of, it seems like it worked out, but maybe but really it kind of didn't.
Yeah.
You know,
so
really,
what was your question?
My question was, this is and I know that we have, you know, I don't want to keep you too long. We want to try
There's
to
one more
this,
thing I want to get to.
We will. I want to make sure we're within time. But my question was very, kind of very nerdy, I think, me being like just a nerd about this. If Ubik is real, mm-hmm. I guess this is something that I thought about a lot, which is, what is the mechanism by which Ubik was created? There seems to be in Half-Life, if we take Ubik at face value, that it's a thing that it was created.
Right.
There's a very scientific, there's just a moment, there's a passage or two where they describe this very scientific process in Cold Pack, Half-Life, where Ubik was created, led by a team, essentially, I think, a team that Ella was in charge of, mm-hmm. of scientists or inventors or something. What are we supposed to think about that? That's something that I thought a lot about. I mean, are we supposed to accept that in Half-Life there's a completely orderly society of the people that are in Half-Life, where they are creating products? I mean, because that's my impression.
That
Ella started a company in Half-Life that produces Ubik and gives it to people who are experiencing trouble with Half-Life. Like, it's a product. Speaking of capitalism, that in Half-Life they've created essentially like some kind of capitalistic entity.
Well, it's one of the moments, right, where you feel as though you've hit a stable floor when you're saying, well, Ella's sort of, she's laying it out for you, you know? She's saying, this is actually what's going on. There's a war going on in Half-Life, in Cold Pack, between the Joris and everybody else. We're fighting it. We've got an underground. You know, we've come up with this process to make Ubik. So now you're in it. This is the rest of your life,
right?
As it were,
right? Like, you've got a disease, and we have a vaccine for it, or we have a, you know, medication you can take that will let you live on, and not continue to get sick. But I'm saying, when you think about what mechanically, what would have to happen? I mean, how is it happening? What is happening in Half-Life that they're able to synthesize of something, which is a chemical or a? Are there? I mean, to me, she's talking about going towards a floating light at the beginning of the book. You know, when you know, she says she was dreaming, but it seems like, you know, when she speaks to Runciter at the beginning, that she was dreaming of a light. But it's unclear that her dream is not just her in Cold Pack when she's not being communicated with, that Cold Pack is a kind of constant dream. And in fact, the way Jory operates in Cold Pack, it seems to indicate that he can move into other people's minds and into their sphere of thought in a very dreamlike way. So I'm just trying to understand the and maybe, again, this is a very nerdy...
You're trying to understand, like, the nature of the reality of Half-Life.
Maybe this is a pedantic, very pedantic kind of line of questioning, but do they have a lab? Is there a building? Well, do they drive cars?
I mean, presumably, what happens in Cold Pack has no actual physical reality, right? So whatever it is has to be some sort of psychological analog to some physical process, because they can't move around in Cold Pack. Nothing's physically happening.
Right. But they...
I mean, I think what he's presenting to us is... What does Half-Life look like to Runciter and his wife? What does it look like to speak with the Half-Life, whatever remains of your dead spouse? It looks kind of depressing. It looks like something that maybe would make you wish you weren't experiencing it, because she seems like she's on drugs, basically.
Yeah, she seems out of it. That's right.
What Joe Chip experiences of Ella is extremely well thought out. She's acting. She's waging a war against this sort of really terrifying guy who goes around telling people he's eating them.
Right. There's not just one Jory, that there are
many. She implies that there are many, one at least in each moratorium or whatever they call them.
Yeah.
What he's doing, and it's not going to answer your question, to me what he's doing is sort of like, what does it feel like to have a dream versus what does it sound like to describe one? That's what it sounds like and feels like to me. He's presenting to, like, being inside of a dream
feels...
Because your dreams
are very detailed with lots of...
And real.
Specific.
And you have a purpose.
Right. But this is what I'm saying. A dream happens for a short period of time and then it ends. You can't answer this question, but it's something that, like, I've been thinking about. Like, how did she get these people together? What are they using...
You know, I just don't think there's a lot of there. I mean, for this, if I were to, the way that I experience this book above all other ways, and there's lots of ways, to me, it's actually a book about depression. To me, it's a book about the way that, depending on how much energy you have to put into investing the reality around you with meaning, it becomes functioning. But when you become depressed, I've had some experience with depression. Things seem to fall apart. They seem to stop meaning anything, and all you want to do is start crawling back to your bed.
You want to lay down,
and it feels as though there's no energy left in the world.
And it's like the reality changes around you,
and it comes back. Things come back to life. They seem important again. They seem to have meaning. They seem to have a narrative coherence, and then the depression comes back, and it all starts to fall apart. That, above all, is what I read this book as being about. But I don't, you know, put that out as a definitive reading. It's just how I experience it.
No, that makes a lot of sense. I think it's also interesting to note that let's say that Joe Chip's depression, you know, which is a very palpable physical kind of depression, is triggered by female characters one way or the other in the book.
Mm-hmm.
It's either Pat has brought him, has crushed him.
Yeah.
Or Ella has revived him.
Yeah. And the Pat parts are powerfully associated with shame, and filth. It seems to be related to his feelings, his problematic feelings about his sexuality.
I just realized I know we have to wrap up in a minute. We've not talked about the clothing at all.
And we also haven't made a joke about Philip Dick K. Dick's name.
That's good.
It's not going to feel complete until...
Well, I'm all ears.
Sometimes when I, you know, I just don't find Dick fully satisfying.
You've been thinking, I'm going to come in here and make
several
that.
Years, actually. I've been holding that in reserve.
Well, you know, sometimes you have to have multiple experiences with Dick before you're fully satisfied.
Okay, now that we've done that, I feel like we can move on.
The clothing. Can you read the G.G. Ashwood description?
Sure.
This is the one that I go
so
back
the first,
to.
The first half of the book, maybe not half, but very, very early on, it's awash in ridiculous clothing descriptions.
I'd love to see it. By the way, if anybody could, who's listening, if they could do a rendering, a drawing of the...
We talked about drawing
some
these.
Cosplay. If there's any cosplay,
that would be great. I would love to
there.
Do a Ubik cosplay where everybody dresses like a character from the... That's a good Halloween idea.
Sure.
Okay.
All right, let's hear some of these descriptions.
This is Pat, Gigi Ashwood said, his arm with ostentatious familiarity around the girl's waist. Never mind her last name. Square and puffy like an overweight brick, wearing his usual mohair poncho, apricot-colored felt hat, argyle ski socks, and carpet slippers. He advanced toward Joe Chip.
So Gigi's coming in from outside. He's wearing, what are carpet slippers? Do you know? I assume that they're like slippers for the home.
Yeah.
I imagine them as being the kind of slippers that a dog would fetch for you if you were sort of a 1950s, you know, guy.
Yeah.
Right.
With a pipe. But he's also wearing
and a mohair poncho.
Mohair poncho.
His usual mohair poncho.
What is mohair? That is a type
it's a type of wool.
So some weird wool drug rug. And a what kind of hat?
Felt
hat.
Apricot colored.
Apricot. Right. Felt hat. And argyle ski socks.
He's in other
so
words,
his legs are
he's
exposed.
Got it going on.
Yeah.
This guy.
But it's not uncommon.
Not wearing pants.
This is
the reason I like this one. It's very short, but it's a description of Joe who seems to not really be in, like, he's not a dandy, you know?
But he everybody's
just,
a dandy.
He just throws something on. And what he throws on is a sporty maroon wrapper, twinkle toes turned up shoes, and a felt cap with a tassel.
Oh, he also has a felt cap.
Mm-hmm. What, like a fez? Or
it seems like it's like a fez.
So if
with turned up shoes.
And this tam o' shanter, it's hard to just reconstruct it.
None of them are wearing pants. I mean, I don't think any.
That's right. And no, and at one point, I think Runciter is wearing a mini skirt.
Pat wears jeans.
Yeah. A man is wearing a mini skirt in one of these scenes. I can't remember who it is. But you know, actually, upon rereading and really taking note of the outfits, it kind of ruined some of that.
Here it is. Who is it? It's Runciter.
It is Runciter. That's what I thought.
It's either Runciter or Tarnish. He's wearing an electric yellow cummerbund, pedal skirt, knee-hugging hose, and military-style visored cap.
That's either a male or female character, but
it's right. A male.
Oh, it is a male.
Yeah,
character.
Because they're
okay.
Both male.
It ruins the if you were to you know. And by the way, I understand Michelle Gondry might be doing a film version of this.
I heard that. Yeah,
which is makes me very depressed because I think that he'll focus on things like their outfits, which I feel like Dick wrote kind of off the cuff. Maybe in a haze, speed haze. At least that's what I hope. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's kind of what I think. Because the story is very serious.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very serious story. And their outfits are the exact opposite of serious. They are like completely comical, cartoonish, flamboyant. And I guess maybe he was thinking this is how people will dress in the future. In 1990, what year is it? Like 91?
92, I think.
92. Yeah.
Yeah. Which was a bad year for fashion in reality.
I mean, I think there may be parallels. There may be actual parallels in fashion in 92.
It was prescient.
To what he describes. Yeah. I mean, certainly men in skirts, that was, a 90s thing.
I mean, this is a good question for you. Do you think, knowing that he wrote at least faster than most people did, do you think he's writing the way that he assumes people will read? Like, do you think it's possible he's just throwing that in there thinking? Because, like, the way that I read, I very often don't, I kind of gloss over the words where they describe the clothing.
Yes.
I'm not that interested.
That's what happened to me. That's why I was so shocked when I reread this.
Yeah, I don't think that it's sort of it's in there, but I don't think it's heavily signifying. I think the bones right. The bones of the plot is what he's expecting people to really to focus on. I don't really see the clothing as a load-bearing part of the narrative.
It's not a structural.
No.
But it's definitely, it kind of makes me feel like he has a sense of humor or.
Oh, Dick definitely had a sense of humor. And I mean, I find his writing to be, maybe I'm alone, but I think that there are, I mean, not in this book, but I think there are other books where there are actual laugh out loud moments.
Mm.
I think if you stop and really take a look at I think the clothing choices are funny. Maybe he wasn't trying to be funny, but they certainly are humorous.
You know, before we wrap up, there's one other thing or quality of the book that I wanted to ask you guys whether you had this experience. The problem that when I have reading Ubik is that it tends to bleed into my real life. I don't know if you guys had that experience, but I start to it starts to creep out of the pages. I was reading it last night, and I've had this kind of infected sort of hangnail on my finger, on my thumb, and when Jory bites Joe in the thumb, I suddenly thought, oh my god, he got to me as well. I also was having trouble finding my phone last night. Turned out I'd left it in the car. I found it this morning, but I felt like Jesus Christ, this is just the beginning.
Yeah.
Things are starting to disappear.
The tires will be flat on the car when you go out there.
Uh-huh.
And I definitely found in much of what Dick writes, and this book is no exception. I don't know what that. here we go.
It's starting to begin.
It's happening. Yeah. The walls are collapsing in this building. It is something very insidious about the about his writing, and something very, maybe it's because the characters aren't, these aren't extreme. I mean, the characters are extreme, but they're not described. I mean, they are, they seem to have extreme qualities, but they're not described in extreme ways. And I, you know, can relate to many of his protagonists. Joe Chip is certainly a character that I relate to on many levels. But there is something in his writing, and there's something I think it really begins with, breaking down the concept, our safe concept of reality. I think his first job, Philip K. Dick's first job, seems to be he just wants to tear down your concept of reality as a safe and knowable thing, and present, you know, the real reality, which is something far less knowable and far scarier.
Yeah.
And as soon as that happens, as soon as that wedge gets in, his books do have a very strong effect on your experience and your kind of waking thinking, rumination on like what's going on around you. And that was what I was saying about Vallis. Vallis was, to me, you know, he had, not to go off on a tangent, but he had these characters where it was Philip K. Dick was a character, and then him, another version of Philip K. Dick that was questioning, you know, where one was questioning the other, and all of these things that he throws up. And in this book, it happens as well about, and are you really experiencing this, or is this a product of your mind?
And you can hear, it's almost as if that explosion on Luna kind of echoes through the culture, because you find it in Paul Auster, then you find it in The Matrix, you find it in Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, you find it in Inception.
Right.
I mean, once that explosion took place on Luna, somehow it's like nothing was ever quite the same.
Well, this is the thing about Dick, is that his fundamental question always seemed to be, what is the nature of reality? I know that's kind of like a, you know, philosophy 101, but the way he presents it is in a very real that's the thing, when I was saying it's explainable, that it has, there's an answer. He presents this kind of setup of, there is an answer. You know, even when he's completely off the deep end in a book like Vallis, he has an answer. He says, there's a technical reason why this is happening, and I can explain the whole thing. And what makes it really scary is that when somebody, it's one thing to say like, well, reality isn't what you think it is. It's another thing to say, reality isn't what you think it is, and here's why. And I think that he does a lot of that. And I think that is, and maybe this matches our kind of, and I'm rambling now, but maybe this matches our paranoid, you know, the paranoid state that we live in, that has just, you know, I think that we live in an increasing state of panic and paranoia about the world around us, that we don't know what's going to happen next. And I think that is, his ideas that were very raw and weird and new in the 60s, that with, you know, and I think that are probably born out of drug use in many ways and the political climate at the time. I think those two things mashing together had a, you know, profound effect on the way we think of reality. But I think that stuff has become very much pop culture now. Now we expect there to be a problem with reality or a problem with what we're told.
And the response to it, this compulsive need to explain, to fill in vacuums and gaps in reality with just profusions of explanation, whether they're conspiracy theories or respectable kinds of theories that just can't be proven one way or the other. We can't leave it alone, right? We just keep picking at these little edges.
Now that you say that, I'm starting to feel that at this moment something is unraveling.
I want to sort of finish up with one question, which is, a reader had a specific question for you, which isn't really about Ubik, but I think it is related in that we were all, it was interesting to watch this book club occur, because it's interesting to watch people who've never read a book read it and also try to sort of make sense of it every step of the way. And I think that this book is like really lends itself to that, because you watch the attention shift from things like Pat and Cold Pack to the sort of things that become more important in the second half of the book. But all three of us were rereading it. And I think that the experience of rereading this book, unlike a lot of books that I've read, you know, I reread books that are my favorite books. This one has a really different character, or it did for me the second time around. And the reader who wrote the question asked, since you included it on your list, he asked basically if you reread the book before you put it in the list, and if you reread like a lot of your other books before you sort of like contributed to the time list. And I think for me, what's interesting about it is like the character of rereading a book. I think the experience is interesting.
Right. To answer the second part first, I did reread everything I put on the list. I didn't do the whole list. There was another guy who did a
well, much of the list, but
the bad selections.
The Man Who Loved Children. I just could never get through that book. That was not mine. But you know, I put Are You There, God? It's Me, Margaret on the list, and I went back to it to make sure it seemed as rich and important as it had when I read it as a kid, and it did. And that wasn't true of everything. And I reread Ubik, and the funny thing about rereading Ubik, unlike any other book that I've reread, it's a lot like reading Ubik for the first time.
Yes.
You know, a lot. You read a book, you know what's going to happen, you know how everything gets sorted out, then you go back and reread it, and maybe you can pay attention to the characterization or stuff like that. Ubik, you get to the end and it's not explained for you, so you go back and you're still in that state of uncertainty. It's just like reading it for the first time. You never really finish this book.
Yeah. I agree. I mean, I was shocked to reread it, just utterly confused. I thought there was whole passages that I didn't recall at all or remembered them differently. And maybe that's my own brain, you know, working badly. Decaying.
The drugs.
The drugs, the decay, the constant request for nickels for my toaster. But you know, my mohair, all of my mohair products are at the cleaner right now. So it's, it is a weird, there is something weird about it that I love the book. I think I read it twice before this time. And I loved it. You know, this is my favorite Philip K. Dick book. And yet, when I reread it, there were things I just did not remember at all. And you'd think, like, your favorite book, you're going to remember every part of it. And I think it is, I mean, part of it is the red herrings. And part of it is just that I think it's...
For a really short book.
A lot of information.
There's a lot there. It's very dense. And I did remember, I see it in this reader question, The Man in the High Castle was the first Philip K. Dick book that I read.
Mm. Oh. Which is really... in a reader question?
Mm-hmm. That's odd. He mentions it.
How does he know?
No, he doesn't. No, he mentioned the book Unrelated.
Wait, that's the first book you read?
That's the first one I read. We had talked about that earlier.
Okay.
And I couldn't remember what it was.
You said you thought it was Flood My Tears, the Policeman Set.
Yeah.
What was the first Dick book you read?
Same, Man in the High Castle.
Man in the High Castle.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a great book. Yeah. That's another one.
I read in the comments somewhere, someone who had read a bunch of his stuff said, oh, you know, The Man in the High Castle is great, but it's really atypical for his work. I actually think that all of his work is atypical for his work. Like, they're all very different. Like, there's not, like, Ubik and The Man in the High Castle and Flow My Tears, the Policeman Said, are all three, they're radically different in their approach.
Mm. And The Man in the High Castle, as, you know, as foundational in its way as Ubik in terms of the whole alternate history genre.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, so much has been produced in imitation of that book, building on it. It's amazing what he did,
yeah,
this guy.
I mean, it's, and then we should end. But I just want to say, I mean, it is it's always interesting to speak to somebody else who I don't know who is a Dick fan who loves Dick. sorry, you started this.
No, I just want you to know that.
To hear the passion, I don't think people get passionate about a lot of authors like this. Mm-hmm. I think there are great books. I think there are great authors. I think people love the works and the writers. But I think there's something about Dick that it just engenders, and it's. We did, you know, we went to the Philip K. Dick Festival, and we have a great video, which you should watch, where we interview a few different Dick scholars. And damn you. Now everything sounds like a joke.
No, I know.
We interview dickheads. And and they talk about this thing. One of them talks about this thing where you first read a Philip K. Dick book, and then you get a bunch of others, and you read them all rapidly because you can't get enough of it. And that was my experience. I don't know if it was yours. But I think there is something about his writing and... I don't know what it is, something magical that just makes you love him and love his ideas and want to just kind of get deeper into the murky depths of his brain.
Mm. And changing speed, October's book is Foucault's Pendulum by Umberto Eco.
You're wrapping us up.
Good transition.
That's great.
Well, I'd like to talk about that book for a moment, but I've never read it.
About Foucault's Pendulum? Very difficult to read, from what I understand, that you've started reading.
I've started reading it several times. I've never given it a full effort.
Lev, I assume you've read it?
Never finished it. Really? I found it very hard.
Well, you can join us if you wish.
This does not bode well for the future of the book club.
Interestingly,
we're shutting down the book club, it turns out, after 1 month and
Interestingly, our readers chose that. We had a poll. We gave them four options.
Is this some kind of advanced trolling? Is it possible that they're like, let's pick a book that no one can finish? Even the most well-read, scholarly of those
Well, in September, they complained that the book was too short and that they read it too fast. And I don't think we'll hear that this month.
No. Well, Lev, thank you very much for joining us for this. It's an incredible pleasure to have you. I'm glad you could take time out. And I would love to, you know, have you back for future book club.
I had a great time.
Conversations. So that is, I think, any final thoughts? I don't want to miss any opportunities here. Would you like anything that you'd like to say?
I'm good.
You're good?
I think we solved it. I think we sorted everything out.
I think
out.
We got it. Turns out Runciter was just dreaming the whole time. And he woke up, probably. Yeah. that's our podcast, and I hope you enjoyed it. You can check our forums in the book club forum for the latest book, which, as Laura said, is Umberto Eco's Foucault's Pendulum, which is very difficult to read. And good luck to all of you. And we'll be back next month. Thanks.
Bye.
Thank you.